Okay, let me hit the okay on this one. One more. Record to the cloud. Okay. Okay, we're live. Hello,
Hello.
everyone. This is Dr. Roger Paul. And tonight we're going to continue our study on paper 48, the Marantia life. Life, right? I was going to say Marantia world, this Marantia life. And we're on paper 47, section 7, paragraph 24. And it's on 557 of the original book. And we don't have very much left on this paper. So we're going to just kind of take our time to go through these. And we should finish this tonight. And next time we'll go on to the next paper in line. And I wanted to mention this to everyone with us tonight. I did do the reading version of this by Merritt Horn, and it's out there under Reading the Urantia
No
Book in
more.
my list on YouTube. And you can find all of those I've done through. And I finished from the Last Supper all the way to the end of the book. So all the papers are out there through the end of the book if you want to try to read or listen to them before Easter. They're all out there. You can hit.
Great.
So you can go through the whole crucifixion and the resurrections, all 19 appearances, and bestow all the spirit of truth, and also the last paper on the faith of Jesus. And they're all out there. And so now I'm going to go ahead and put our papers as we do them, each week out there. I'll put those out there from the other papers. And they're going to be in blue because they don't have a lot of words in Jesus. So I don't have to worry about the red washing out. So they're going to be in blue. And I think I'm going to go ahead and do them with the pictures too that we do when we study. So we'll have the version with the pictures that Merritt Horn reads. You won't be able to spend a lot of time on the pictures, but you can pause your video on YouTube and look at them as long as you want. And the other thing is, I'm going to start in the next few days doing the life of Christ from the beginning. I did paper 119 already. I thought that would be a good place to start doing the rest of the life of Christ and go back up to the Last Supper again. So I'm going to get them all out there so the entire life of Christ is out there and videos that you can just sit and listen to. Those are nice videos to just sit and listen to. Let him read to us. So it's a good study. And welcome, everybody. Glad to see you back again, Roy, Jane,
Thank you.
Pam, Gary, Tim, Diane. Who are
Glad to
you?
be here with everybody. Glad to
All
be here.
right. Let's get started. Let's see here. First paragraph. You want to read the first paragraph too?
22. The evolving soul is not made divine by what it does, but by what it strives to do.
Long reading, wasn't
That's
it?
awesome, though.
Awesome though.
Yeah, really.
All right, let's talk about this just a second. The soul's not made divine. Now, we talked about this, how the soul and the thought adjuster paper last week, right? The working of creating the soul is the thought adjuster's job while we're on this planet, but it says it's not made divine by what it does, right? But what it strives to do. So what you strive to do in life makes a difference. It really does. So, and it's not so much what you get done, it's what you are trying to do or your intent. And we've talked about intent before, and this is very important for people when they go on getting ready to pass on to the mansion world because of why? You are judged not on what you do, but your intent of what you do. Okay, so that's very, very important. If you set out to change the world and make the world better, what's that mean? That means you get credit for at least trying to make the world better, right? That's real important. Or whatever you're working on or whatever you're doing, it does help, right?
Yeah, being a great grandpa.
Right. He is being a good grandpa.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go on to the next one here. If I can find the right. There we go. Let's see who's next. Tim, you're up next.
Death added nothing to the intellectual possession or to the spiritual endowment, but it did add to the experiential status, the consciousness of survival.
Let me tell y'all how important death is, okay? The experience of dying is so important that every single creator son has to go through this experience, all 700,000 of them, at least once. Okay, so that's how important the experience of death is in itself. And there's no way that you can learn about death without experiencing it. And what am I talking about? It's the consciousness of ending your life, okay? And waking up in a new existence, okay? So even Jesus had to go through this. He had to die materially as a human, and he had to revive himself. Everyone else, they revive us for us. But Jesus had to revive himself in the Marantia form all by himself. But that experience of dying as a human is required for all 700,000 creator sons. That's how important it is.
Hey, Roger.
So, yeah.
I just wanted to give a small little note that, you know, death is sort of like losing consciousness, like you're falling asleep. So it's really not something that we should be afraid of.
No.
More or less, if you die from a bad disease, that could be horrible. But in terms of death itself, it's just like falling asleep and then reawakening on shores of a better world.
Yeah, the experience of death is nothing to be feared whatsoever. The thing that people fear, I think, more than anything else, is the fact that how you die. Because if you die in a hospital bed full of pain and stuff, that's not a good way to go, any way you look at it. Yeah, Gary. You have your hand up? Gary?
I don't see him. Oh, there he is. You're on mute.
You're muted, Gary.
What is that sound?
Why did Jesus have to revive himself?
Because he's a
creator
son.
Bring himself back to life and not God the Father.
It's a creator son. Gary, if you go out and listen to the first paper on the time in the tomb and the resurrection, it explains this very well, how all the celestial beings that normally revive us on the mansion worlds, they were all puzzled because they were there at the tomb and they saw the master there dead in the tomb. But they, in a normal person, they would, the guardian angel would transport your soul to the mansion worlds. But with the creator son, they were not able to do that. They're not allowed to do it. So that's why Jesus, as a creator son, had to revive himself. He had to revive himself, make himself in the Marantia form, and then it was the job of the energy transformers and all the Marantia personnel that takes care of bodies and this sort of thing to give him a body to use. Okay, so he would have a body exactly like the one we get when we wake up on the mansion worlds, on the first mansion world. But to be put in that body, they could not do that for a creator son. None of them can. So all 700,000 of the creator sons have to resurrect themselves. And that's why they call it a resurrection. You're being taken from one form of life into a new existence or a new dimension. And that's the Marantia dimension. And we know there's three dimensions, don't we, at least? You know, there's many, many dimensions, but the three main ones are what? Mortal or physical, Marantia, and then spiritual. Okay, so Jesus had to experience all seven of the mansion worlds in the Marantia form, which he did on this planet, most of it. Okay, so during the resurrection, when he made appearances, the 19 appearances, in between each appearances, sometimes he'd make several, and then he'd be transferred to the next mansion world, and then he might make another one, and he'd be transferred to the next mansion world. So with each transformation, it made it more and more difficult for the mechanical controllers to make him visible to human beings when he came down during the resurrection, which is really important because he was becoming more and more a higher level of Maranatha as he went along. So that made him less and less visible to humans. So they had to make modifications so they could, we could actually see Jesus, or the persons that he appeared to could actually see Jesus after.
Well, and also they responded to his voice rather than what they saw.
Yeah, they say over and over again they didn't recognize him because he didn't look exactly like he did as a mortal, did he? I mean, on this planet. He looked probably as a mortal, but he probably didn't look exactly like he did face-wise and that sort of thing. He may have been more beautiful even than he was here. You know what I'm saying? So, but he would have been different than that. And the interesting part is this. They say that when we wake up on the mansion worlds, we all look to be around 30 years old. Okay, somewhere in the 30s. All right.
We'll be good looking then.
Yeah, well, we should be good looking guys. That's right. And, you know, it's interesting that probably our families and our friends and spouses and things like that may not recognize our physical form exactly like we were. You know what I'm saying? They will recognize us as soon as we say something because we'll have the same voice patterns and habits and that sort of thing. So, you know, you may wake up and be totally beautiful. That's something to look forward to, right?
Wouldn't it be more like personality? They will recognize you by your personality?
Personality and voice, yes.
And voice, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, just like they did Jesus. You know, as soon as Jesus, when he was talking to Mary outside the tomb, when he said, Mary, she recognized who he was because he had those same patterns of love and affection he had for all his disciples and apostles. You know, so as soon as they heard that, they knew it was Jesus. You know, it'd be like if you woke up, you know, you were in a bad accident, right? And they had to rebuild your face and made you look into a different person completely. When you spoke to your friends or relatives, they would know who you are right away, right? Because your personality didn't change, only your appearance. You still out there, Roy?
I guess what I want to ask, I know the seven bestowals, but he came in different life forms. So you're saying that once he reincarnated here on Urantia, that every time he was seen that he changed again?
He did, because he was going up the levels of the Urantia worlds, the mansion worlds, right? And with each one of those changes, he got farther and farther away from the material. Okay. And as you get farther away from the material and closer to the spiritual, it would be harder for someone on a different level to recognize you. And that's the same when you get to the mansion worlds. Okay. So when Jesus, let me give you an example of that. When Jesus woke up on the first mansion world, if he was actually on the first mansion world, then you would have seen him easily as a first mansion world citizen, right? Easily. But when he transformed into a spiritual being, you may not be able to see him as readily as you did as a Maranatha being, because he would be on the spiritual level. So it would require the mechanical physical controllers of the Maranatha spheres to make your eyes visible to see the spiritual Jesus at that point. Right?
Hey, Roger.
Yeah.
I noticed Ron used the word, Roy used the word reincarnate. Is that correct?
That's still correct. Really, when you think about it, when we move from level to level, from world to world, we really are reincarnated as the same individual personality, but we're reincarnated in a higher level. So you could call it reincarnation or translation, or there's a lot of different terms you could use, but it's not reincarnated in the sense that you're given a body, an earthly body again. That does not ever happen, right?
And I guess I asked that question because in his seven bestowals, he came to different phases of existence of his creation. Like Melchizedek's and all those different ones. So,
right.
But on Urantia, He came in different phases of all the Marantia existence.
And, yeah, all the mortal existence and all the Marantia existence also. Now, an interesting thing is this. During one of the bestowals, I just did this a couple days ago. During one of the bestowals, he was a spiritual being, a mortal spiritual being in Uversa at the level where people go from Uversa to Havona. Okay. But when he served his bestowal there, he was considered a high mortal spiritual being. Okay. A mortal that had gotten to that point. So it's interesting because of the bestowals, the importance of this bestowals are so important to us is this: our creator son, Jesus, did a bestowal in every level of being that him and the local universe mother spirit created. Okay, so he's experienced from the highest level of beings like Melchizedek's down to the lowest levels of beings like mortals. So he's had experience in each level, and all the creator sons do this so they can understand what it's like being every level of being they create. All right, and that makes them good rulers. That makes them sympathetic, merciful rulers. If that wasn't the case, you could see why maybe a creator son might decide that I don't understand what these beings are talking about, but he will never be in that situation because he's been there, right? Jane, did you have a question, dear?
I just wanted to comment and ask if it's a correct comment. Can we use the word reincarnate until we become spirit only, like when we fuse?
Yeah, you could. It would be
that we couldn't say incarnate. I don't know if there is a different word for that. A being, maybe a form. I don't know what it would be, but incarnate means we have not achieved spirit yet.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. So that would be correct all the way up to the spiritual level, right? But it makes me wonder, Jane, it's a good thing you asked that question, because it makes me wonder, after we fuse with the adjuster and we become part of divinity, I don't know that reincarnate would be a proper term any longer.
That's what I'm asking. Yeah, I don't think it would be either.
I don't think it would be a proper term at that point. Mm-hmm. Right?
What about the term evolve?
Evolve would be correct. Right? Because we're constantly evolving. But because of that spark of divinity we fuse with, we become part of divinity, right? Y'all understand that. So I don't know that you could call it reincarnation any longer, because you're not reincarnating as just a mortal being any longer. You are incarnating as a new level future spiritual being. Because of the father fragment. Makes sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I know that seems tearing it all apart, but that's a good question. Very good question.
Could you say Marantia transition?
Marantia transition's correct all the way up to the system capital, or up to the local universe capital. And at that point, you turn into spirit, first stage spirit, right? Okay, let's go on to our next. We're going to definitely get rid of these tonight. Okay. Boy, it keeps rearranging everything on me here. Jane, why don't you take the next one, and then we'll go down to the next line online.
Okay. The destiny of eternity is determined moment by moment by the achievements of the day-by-day living. The acts of today are the destiny of tomorrow.
That's a great quote, isn't it? Mm-hmm. The acts of today are the destiny of tomorrow. So what you do, every moment of your existence, every moment of your living, all right, adds to or takes away from you growing spiritually. Does that make sense? So every moment you're doing something and every moment of your day can add to your future destiny of tomorrow, because it all becomes, anything spiritual becomes permanent, right? Goes into your soul and becomes part of your destiny. That's a great quote.
Okay. Do you remember that follow-up quote where it says, the axe is ours, the consequence is God's? That's
right.
Yeah. Yes, of a similarity, like, yeah. It yeah, is. I love that
That's
one.
That's a good very, one.
Yeah, very mm-hmm. similar. Yeah. All right, Rodney, would you take the next one?
Yes. 25. Greatness lies not so much in possessing strength as in making a wise and divine use of such strength.
Yes, guess what that is. Great making the wise and divine so use. What was that, Gary?
The adjuster.
Mm-hmm. The adjuster. That's right.
The adjuster. Yeah.
Following the adjuster's lead, right? It's not, the greatness lies not so much in possessing. It's not what we mentally possess, right, as strength. But what makes us strong is using that not my will, but your will be done concept, and let the adjuster work through us and gives us that divine strength, right?
Hey, Roger.
Yeah.
How do you allow the adjuster to lead you? If it's just focused on values like truth, beauty, and goodness, and starting from there?
Well, I like to think of it as Jesus. How did Jesus do it? In every act he did on this planet, everything, what did he always say?
Not my will, but your will be done.
Bingo. That's it, right? Not my will, but your will be done. So when you go through your life and you're doing this and that and the other, what should be in the back of your mind all the time?
Not the my Father's will.
That's right. Not my will, but your will be done. And if you live your life like that, don't you think that God will, actually the Spirit of Truth will lead you into the right path? Why is it the Spirit of Truth? Because the Spirit of Truth works in conjunction with God the Father. Okay? And if it's God the Father's will, the Spirit of Truth is our physical connection, our over control connection from the local universe to put us in the proper pathways. It's both our sword and our shield. Why do I call it that? Our sword for the action and our shield to protect us from evil, right? That's our sword and our shield, right? So if you think to yourself, not my will, but your will be done, the Spirit of Truth will lead you in the pathways you need to go along with whom else? The local universe Mother Spirit through the Holy Spirit, okay?
So what you're saying is the Mother Spirit would basically be the shield portion, and the doing what God's will would be our sword, which is the path. That's the action, correct. And the Mother Spirit would be the shield. Why doesn't the thought adjuster do that?
Because
I would have thought that would be his job.
That comes from paper one. The God the Father never does aught. Anything. That's what that means. Never does anything. Never does aught that his children can do for him. Nothing. And who's his children? The Eternal Son, the Infinite Spirit, the Creator Sons, the Local Universe Mother Spirit, the Ancients of Days, the Seven Master Spirits. All these are the children of God, and he never does anything that these beings can do for him. Why would he not do that? Why does he always gives it out to somebody else to do?
He would overstep their boundaries.
It would overstep their boundaries of having the free will choice to doing the will of God, just like us. They work just like us. Okay? So by allowing all these downsteppings of God the Father, from the very top all the way to the bottom, it allows each one of us to gain experience. And what else does that do? The experience is also gained by the thought adjuster, which becomes part of us, right? So the thought adjuster gains experience and we gain experience. But if he's just stepped in and did it over them, then all the rest of the seven parts of deity would not get the experience from it. You see that?
We can also simply say, in my very simplistic form of thinking, God gives and never takes back. He doesn't take what he gives.
That's right. Never takes back.
He doesn't take it back. Yeah. He gives totally, completely, fully, unconditionally.
That's correct.
Right? Even the creator son, like Michael, when Lucifer was going against him and he knew.
Yes.
He could have ordered him to cease and desist.
Oh, yeah, in a heartbeat. Yeah,
like the father, just like the father,
he
gave and doesn't take back.
Well, you hit the key right there, Jane, is just like the father, because who is Jesus? Jesus is the representation of the father to us, right?
Yeah. Our universe father.
Our universe father, just like the father. You hit it on the head. Gary, would you take this next one, please?
Number 26, knowledge is possessed only by sharing. It is safeguarded by wisdom and socialized by love.
Okay, we've heard this before. I've said it many times before. How do we learn when we get to the mansion worlds?
By teaching.
By teaching. Mm-hmm. You learn by teaching. So when you're going out through your world here in this crazy world, how do you share the knowledge that you have gained from this wonderful experience of life? You share it. Yeah, you pass it around, right? Don't hold it for just yourself. So it's safeguarded by wisdom and socialized by love. How do you share it and love one another? The fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. You know, when I was reading through, I think it was the paper on the Pentecost. When I was reading through that, it hit me that all these things we do in life, everything we do in life means nothing unless you've shared it with someone else. And that is why the importance of the message of Jesus. What was the message of Jesus? The gospel is this, the fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. The gospel was not that Jesus died for your sins, was it? The gospel wasn't the resurrection of Jesus, was it? Like Paul tried to make it and Peter tried to make it, right? Peter tried to make it at Pentecost. Changed the gospel immediately to the risen Lord, didn't he? But that was not the message Jesus wanted them to teach. He wanted them to teach what? The fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. Now, to have the brotherhood of man, what do we have to have? We have to have number 26 here, right? As part of the brotherhood of man. Knowledge is possessed only by sharing. Only by sharing with other brothers do we safeguard the wisdom, and it's socialized by love. That's what he's talking about, the brotherhood of man. Make sense? Am I talking through my ears? No. Okay.
No, it's good.
All right, let's go on to the next one. We're going to get through these tonight, aren't we? All right, let's see who's next. Pam, you're up next.
27, progress demands development of individuality. Mediocrity seeks perpetuation in standardization.
So if you want to progress spiritually, what do you do? You stay your individual. You don't have to be in a group belief situation, because you can become mediocre by doing that. You need to stay an individual. That's why you're given personality, and you don't have to standardize your beliefs with someone else. There's a billion people on this planet, and they can all have a billion different concepts of their own development, right? That's just fine, all right? So you don't have to listen to Roger Paul or what anything he says, okay? You only do it because it's fun, right? least we hope it's fun.
Anyway. Well, yeah. I think what you're saying, Roger, we listen, but then we all have to interpret it. And there is that word incorporate.
That's right. And filter out.
Incorporate of our own, according to our own understanding and our own soul growth.
That's right.
Which it will all differ from one to another.
It is.
And that's where the difference is found.
Yeah, it really is. If we if we have stayed together, some of us 10, 12 years now, if y'all all sounded like me, you didn't learn anything, did you?
Correct, yeah.
All right.
Because so what we have to do is, if I may add to Jane's comment, I think we also have to incorporate beyond incorporate. We have to live it.
You have to live it. That's right. Yeah. Learning it doesn't mean anything. If you don't incorporate it in your existence, you don't add to your what? Your soul trust, right? The only way you add to your soul trust is experience, so that the thought adjuster can add that to your soul. So when you wake up on the mansion worlds, you have experiences that are going to come back to you and you go, oh, yeah, I got it, right? You know, the light bulb comes on.
I think it's important just to mention, Roger, that you're really helping us out with, you know, the spirit of understanding, because you're giving us ideals.
Hopefully.
I mean,
so.
I don't know how to interpret this stuff.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. All right. Now, Jane, did you read yet? Because it keeps messing up my order here.
I don't know.
Okay. Well,
yes,
read this
did,
next
Jane.
One. And
I did. Timothy
okay, well,
didn't. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know if Roy has.
That's why I was going to Roy next. That's why I was asking if she. I thought she had read before, so
I did. Yes.
Okay. Go ahead, Roy. Would you take the next one?
Yeah. The augmentative defense of any proposition is inadvertently proportional to the truth contained.
All right. This is an interesting statement for the very last one. All right, so what is this telling us here? All right, when you get in an argument and you're trying to defend any concept, any proposition, all right, it's inversely proportional to the truth contained. In other words, it's just the opposite of the truth contained. So if you want to defend something, you have to make your argument as close to simple and truthful as humanly possible, right? Because they're opposites of each other. Did y'all get that?
Hey, no. Roger.
Yeah.
There was a Christian woman evangelizing, and she was saying, you cannot become godlike because that's like trying to be like Satan. And immediately I just felt that was wrong.
It is wrong. Yeah, you're right.
I thought, why would you say something like that?
Yeah, you want to become godlike because being godlike is opposite of what Satan is, right?
Yeah.
I've said this many, many times. You know, I just redid the Lucifer papers and the problems with the Lucifer rebellion, and I always come back to the me syndrome, right? You want to get in trouble, start saying it's all about me, right? That's what Lucifer did, you know. It's not about us. It's about everybody, right? And when you get into that me syndrome, you're going to explode your brain. You're going down the wrong road, right? Because you get so involved with your own me, you forget us, and the world, right? So,
you know, you just made the argument against materialism, because a materialism is a basic action or function of me.
Selfishness, right?
I thought I did, but I said it better.
I like to piggyback on that too. What Gary just said. I was thinking about what he said. Back to number 26. Knowledge is possessed only by sharing.
Yes.
And so I've always, I looked at it from my personal life, that I've always been an open person and a giving person. And a lot of times you give and you give it, and it's taken and received by, you know, others, but it's not given. And, you know, I guess you could say that our world is like that knowledge. You think about it in any form. Think about medicine, how corporation hoard secrets that could cure of the diseases and all the things that are going on in this world right now. And but they hoard it so that they can make profit off it.
Mm-hmm. Profit-based. Everything's profit-based.
And so I said that to say this. Sometime when I've done that, given to peoples, and I've seen it used in the wrong way, and I try to pull back from being such an open sharing person, you know, I can't do it. And then I have to say, well, you know what? I don't have to change. This is what God called me to be. This is what it's going to be. You just need to catch up with that.
That's right, Roy. And don't you ever change. We love you just exactly the way you are, right? And when you're not there, let me put it this way. You know, Roy was with us early. I don't know. Remember when it was 2012 or 13, something like that. I don't know.
Yeah.
But Roy's work took him off to do other things. You know, and I told him, I said, come if you can, come if you don't, that's okay. But Roy, we all loved you. We still love you. And we would be disappointed if you would have come back a different person than you were in 2012. And you're not going to, because of you're a loving, giving human being, and we love you just the way you are, right? And so it's funny, it's kind of akin to waking up in the mansion worlds. You know, you were gone for a couple of years. I don't know how long you were gone, but you were gone for a short period of time. But when you woke up and came back to us, we woke up at the same time, and we have the same relationship you had the last time I saw you, right?
Yes, we did.
You know, and that's the way it works. And that's the way loving one another works with everybody. You know, if you love another person, those people, regardless of what they do, come and go or whatever, you're going to love them just because of their personality and who they are, just the way they are, right?
Yeah.
All right. So let's go on to the next paragraph here so we can get through this tonight. This is kind of an odd paragraph. I'll just read it. Such is the work of the beginners on the first mansion world, while the more advanced pupils on the later worlds are mastering the higher levels of cosmic insight and Marantia Molda. So these were the beginning steps. The higher on the higher mansion worlds, people get into a little bit heavier things having to do with cosmic insight and Marantia Molda. And this is how we fit into the universe, right?
So it's philosophy.
So it's philosophy, any way you look at it, right? Okay. My lovely wife is going to read the next one here. Let me find my mouse again.
Eight, the Marantia Progressors. From the time of graduation from the mansion worlds to the attainment of spirit status in the super universe career, ascending mortals are denominated Marantia Progressors. Your passage through the wonderful borderland life will be an unforgettable experience, a charming memory. It is the evolutionary portal to spirit life and the eventual attainment of creature perfection by which ascenders achieve the goal of time, the finding of God on paradise.
Yeah. Isn't it interesting that they always are teaching us this is the next step? This is the next step. This is where you're going. This is why you're doing this, right? And it's interesting here, they call us Marantia Progressors. So we're not doing what? We're not sitting still, are we? We're moving, we're progressing each and every day. And you could really call us Marantia Progressors in this life, couldn't you? Because your Marantia Molda starts here. So you can go to sleep tonight and think to yourself, I'm a Marantia Progressor. I'm on my way to the spirit world, right? That's a nice thought, right? And all this later will be a charming memory, right? All right, Tim, would you take the next one?
Okay, let me switch views. Okay, speaker view, okay. There is a definite and divine purpose in all this Marantia and subsequent spirit scheme of mortal progression. This elaborate universe training school for ascending creatures, it is the design of the creators to afford the creatures of time to graduate opportunity to master the details of the operation and administration of the grand universe. And this long course of training is best carried forward by having the surviving mortar climb up gradually and by actual participation in every step of the ascent.
Okay, so think of it this way. This ascent we're making down up through the mansion worlds, up through the universes and all this other stuff is allowing us to experience administration of the universe from the very lowest point to the very highest point. And this is preparing us for what is to come in the future in the outer space levels. Okay, so there is a purpose in all this. And the whole grand universe is involved in setting it up so that we as mortals can experience all this and learn all this so that we can become useful for future use, right? And it's all in how we take advantage of it and how we work on it, right?
Well, the grand universe is just so huge and massive.
Oh, yeah. It's just
so much, yeah.
Unbelievable almost. Isn't it? Okay. Did I skip over one?
No, you just
did. Is that the one we just did? I just did. Okay, there we go. The mortal survivor. Okay, Rodney, you're next.
Could I get the long one?
Yes.
No.
I saved this one just for you because I love you so
welcome.
Much.
Welcome to the club, Rodney.
Rodney says, don't love me so much.
I just had a long one just a few minutes ago.
Okay, the mortal survival plan has a practical and serviceable objective. You are not the recipients of all this divine labor and painstaking training, only that you may survive just to enjoy endless bliss and eternal ease. There is a goal of transcendent service concealed beyond the horizon of the present universe age. If the gods design merely to take you on one long and eternal joy excursion, they certainly would not so largely turn the whole universe into one vast and intricate practical training school. Requisition a substantial part of the celestial creation as teachers and instructors, and then spend ages upon ages piloting you one by one through this gigantic universe school of experiential training. The furtherance of the scheme of mortal progression seems to be one of the chief businesses of the present organized universe. And the majority of innumerable orders of created intelligences are either directly or indirectly engaged in advancing some phase of this progressive perfection plan.
So the whole universe is turned upside down just to train you and give you experience for this future mission, right? And believe it or not, all these people out there that never heard of this, when you get to heaven, you're not going to be sitting on a cloud playing a violin. Okay. As they say in the South, ain't going to happen, right?
That's I'm glad of that because I've been practicing the harp for years now. I'm just joking.
But you will have you will have your Marantxa harp just to communicate.
That's right. You will have your Marantxa harp. Yeah. So don't be disappointed.
This kind of answers a question I had in mind. Is the next Marantxa world harder than this world? And the reason I was thinking of that, because I've talked to many people, not many people, but I've talked to people that have said, you know, in various times in their life, they were willing to tap out, suicide, got, you know, like, yeah, a little bit suicidal.
Yeah.
And I can see if every life experience was as strenuous as this one, it, you know, why, well, there would be such a mortality rate, because I think we have 570 lessons to learn.
Yeah, different Marantia bodies. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, Gary. And yeah, if there is as strenuous as this, the probability of getting to the end is kind of, you know, very low.
Okay, Gary, let me put it this way. It's not a cakewalk, okay? There's work to do when you get there. It's not something you're going to sit around and bliss the whole time that you're there, but it's not got the struggles of mortal existence any longer. You don't have to deal with death and disease and making a living and feeding yourself and paying the bills and raising children and that sort of thing. Those stresses are gone. The new stresses will be intellectual and spiritual stress that you can learn. So that's why they talk about the need for mortals to experience humor, okay? Because more mortals need humor so that they can, it's a relief valve, if you would, for over intellectualization and over stress from thinking, well, I got to do this, I got to do that, because that's the way our human beings, that's the way we go through life. But when you get there, you're not on a time schedule anymore. You know, you don't have to worry about, I got to do this, I got to do that, I got to, no, it's not like that at all. But there's still lessons to learn, and it's equally divided between playtime, work time, and rest and worship. Right. Yeah. So, and it's all balanced. So we don't have this craziness when we have in this world. Think about all the times that men and women go to work, sometimes three jobs, just to feed their family, you know, and it happens all over the world. And there's people starving all over the world. So the stress of this world, yes, I can understand why people want to get out of it. You know, I, honest to God, I look forward to the next world too. You know, we all do, but we can't hurry our way to it. That's the whole point. It's out there and it's for us to enjoy when we get there, but we have to have patience that the experience we're gaining on this world is worth the time we put in for it. Okay, because this experience, we can't get anywhere else, right?
So we need to climb Jacob's ladder one step at a time.
One step at a time, yeah. Right? What's that old saying, Rome wasn't built in a day? You know, it's just one step at a time. You take a step, you look back and say, oh yeah, I got that. Then you take another step. So it's that's life. You know, I've talked about this before, and going through a human existence are different stages of how old, as we're getting old, we have what? We have the child stage, we have the young adult stage, then we have the full adult stage, then we have the elderly stage. Our existence through the universe is kind of like that too. We have different stages that we're going to go through, we're going to exist through, and we're going to look back and say, oh yeah, I got that from this, I got this from this, right? It's the experience that we'll gain, and it puts experience into the supreme for all the universe, right? So you can't ever feel like what I'm doing is not worthwhile. Everything that you do is worthwhile in one shape or form of another, right? No matter
what.
So,
it makes me want to, yeah, go ahead, Ron. Go ahead.
So once the stress of this world are not carried over into the mansion world.
The next world. Yeah.
Yeah. But at that point, you know, a lot of things in this life, we don't have anybody to help us with. All along the way from this point on, I mean, after we wake up on the mansion world, we have help.
Yes, always.
Yeah, all the way.
We got Marantia companions. We got angels. We got all the cherubim that teach us. We have all these beings that are available to help us along all the time that we have in this world, but we can't see them, can we?
Right.
None of them. We don't see anybody. So, you know, we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's 7 of us here tonight. No, 8 of us here tonight. With 8 of us here tonight, we got 8 times 4 and just angels sitting here with us and learning, trying to help us learn, right? How many
you know, angels it makes, is that, you know,
right? You know, that's a lot of beings that's helping us out, but we don't see them, right? Even though they're there. I guarantee they're there. I wish I could say, hey, show one of you guys back there, you know?
Yeah. Uh-huh. But it makes sense you ask, you know.
It'd be nice if I could say, show all of them behind all of us. Now, wouldn't that be a video?
Roger?
Yeah.
How's it feel to be teaching a class where 3/4 of the students are smarter than you?
Much smarter. They must stand back here and laugh, Gary, and say, where do you get that from?
Yeah. You know what I'm referring to.
Yeah, I don't have any false impressions that I know everything. None whatsoever. If nothing else, this book teaches you to be humble.
Hey, Roger.
Yeah.
It kind of makes me think, what am I doing here? But experience plays a really big part of that, correct? In terms of life? Okay.
Really big part of it, right? Okay, let's see. Gary, you get the privilege of the last paragraph here.
Uh-huh. I shouldn't have opened my mouth, right?
Yeah.
Okay. In transversing the ascending scale of living existence, from mortal man to the deity embrace, you actually live the very life of every possible phase and stage of perfected creature existence within the limits of the present universe age. From mortal man to paradise finality embraces all that now can be, encompasses everything presently possible to the living orders of intelligence, perfected finite creature being. If the future destiny of the paradise finalities is service in new universes, now in the making, it is assured that in these new and future creations, there will be no created orders of existing
experiential.
Thank you. I'm trying to say that. Shading one more time and I'll start.
Experiential.
Experiential beings whose lives will be wholly different from those which mortal finalities have lived on some world as a part of their ascending training. As one of the stages of their age-long process, from animal to angel, and from angel to spirit, and from spirit to God. I never thought we'd go from spirit to God.
Yeah, think of it this way. Y'all are going to get to experience every possible situation, impression, learning experience there is in the entire universe.
It's not suggesting that we become angels, right? But we learn from them.
No, we learn from the angels. They go through it with us. So we get the experience of all this, all the way from the very bottom, all the way through to the very top of administration, freedom, friendships, love, eating, drinking, everything you could possibly think of existence, we will experience by the time we become paradise finaliters. And why is this? This prepares us for going out into the future universes, and that way there will be no experience we come upon that we haven't personally experienced ourselves. Okay? That's being a good administrator. That's what Jesus did. He experienced everything of everything he created. Yeah.
It says we go, age-long progress from animal to angel, that's Marantra.
Right.
And from angel, Mirage, to spirit, that would be the fifth level, the immersion with
the sixth level. Yeah, that's the sixth level of spirit. And to God, yeah. It means we will stand before God. We will meet
God. And to God, okay, we won't be his neighbor and tell him to mow his yard or anything like that.
No. No, not at all. Okay. Not at all. So every experience, and this was presented by an archangel of guess where?
Nebadon,
our local universe, right? Okay, and next time we'll do the inhabited worlds. Let me stop the share so they can see everybody here. All right, and that finishes paper 48. We'll go on to paper 49 next time, and I will I'll put that out in the reading format before our next meeting too, sometime this week. Have y'all enjoyed any of the papers that I put out, the reading versions that I put out at all?
I've actually done, which surprises me, which is good for me because I procrastinate, quite a few of them.
Yeah, they're short. So, you know, they're mostly 30 to 40 minutes long, and you can get through one in one sitting pretty easily. You know, I thought that was a great way to do that. And there's people all over the world that can't get access to a book. So this is a great way. If they get YouTube, they can actually read the book from the papers.
Is this on your various platforms?
Yeah, it's on Vimeo. It's on YouTube. It's under youtube.com/RogerPaulDC.
You know, this is... Actually, you know, maybe not realize it as a tremendous service to all for the simple reason that you're providing them an audio book. For instance, I have hearing aids and my hearing aids are connected to my phone. So so you know, you can hear, yeah. You can understand, you can hear on the phone, right?
Every night. Yeah.
You click on these things.
Yeah.
And you hit play and you can be driving down the street listening to the book, which is really nice.
Yeah, it's
better than hearing this garbage we hear on the television and news and whatever.
Well, you know, we're on three different formats. We're on Facebook, we're on Vimeo, and then we're on YouTube. I was looking the way I had it set up on YouTube, I moved the reading papers up higher on my main page, where the Roger Paul DC, youtube.com, Roger Paul DC. I moved it up to the top so that people could find it first and they can listen to the papers. But in doing that, I was looking through settings and stuff like that. And we've had 14,000 impressions. In other words, there's 14,000 people that's listened to one or more of our papers, our meetings. So that's
wonderful.
That's good. You know, I mean,
is that one week or is it a lifetime?
No, that's over a period of how long we've been in there. And for a religious thing, that's pretty good, you know, because some of our papers, we only have 5 or 6 listens on YouTube. Now we've got many, many more of that on Vimeo and Facebook. It doesn't count them on those. But for just Facebook, I think we have 647 videos I put out there on YouTube, and we have 164 subscribers, I think. And I get a breakdown every month. Every month we have, you know, at least 3,000 or 4,000 hours of or minutes of listening. So people are listening to these, you know, a little bit at a time. It takes a long time. It's not like if you go out to YouTube and these people have, you know, 1 million lessons and stuff like that. You know, I'm not expecting that unless the Urantia book gets very, very popular very, very quickly, then people will be looking for things like this.
Go ahead. I just had a conversation with another group. We have another group. Roy knows about it, the one that meets on Sunday, Roy. But they had a new member join, and he's new to the book, and he's just in elations about it.
Yeah.
And he was asked a question, why don't more people know about the book? And I through my mind, why doesn't they advertise it?
Because there was a mandate when the book was given to the group of Chicagoans, when it was given to them, that they were not supposed to publicize it yet because they wanted the book to have the opportunity to be learned by a group of teachers so that when the book became popular, there would be teachers out there to help people to understand it. And that's exactly what happened. That's what I do, right? And if I was born in 1954, the book was revealed in 1955. So maybe I was the baby that somebody had so that they would have a teacher. You know, we don't know these things, but it was for the next generation of people coming out. And this was 1955. So the generation that it was revealed to was just allowed to read the book and benefit from it, but they wanted teachers to develop and groups to develop so that it would start very, very slowly, which it has. And we're getting into the age where I expect any day somebody's going to go on, you know, Tucker Carlson or someplace and talk about the book, and then it's just going to explode, right? And it could happen anytime. We just don't know. You know, I hope when they get somebody that goes on one of these shows or whatever, they know enough about the book to explain it so that it doesn't turn people off from reading the book. And that's the most important thing. You know, they need somebody knowledgeable to explain the basics of the book so that people will be interested in reading it, because it will change billions and billions of lives once it gets there. Right.
You know, so, I have pretty reliable information. The guy that's in Harvard or Yale, the physicist, he looks like a Japanese guy or Oriental. Yeah,
I know you're talking about.
He is a reader of the book.
Oh, he is.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Been for years. I know of a guy that was, he's in the same fraternity, and he communicated with him, and he's trying to introduce him to the book. He says, I've been reading it for 10 years. That's been quite a while ago.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so what you're saying is we're probably on the precipice of something like that happening.
We may be. You know, I mean, look at how much is known, come out about UFOs in the last 5 years, right? You would never hear that kind of stuff mentioned before, you know, 5-10 years ago. Just what, you know, they wouldn't put it on the TV stuff, right? But now look at all the information we have out here. I mean, what an age. You know, me and my wife sit and watch Daniel Boone from the 60s in the evenings for entertainment. You know, I mean, what an age it is. You can go out and watch something from some totally different time and enjoy it and be entertained by it, you know. And I'm hoping by putting these videos out on the different formats that they will be available once I'm gone, because I know I'm, you know, I'm a short timer here. We're all short timers here. We're going on. But I hope that the future worlds will benefit from the teachings that we're trying to do here, right?
Well, you know what happened to me, Roger? Well, I listened and I listened, and then finally I got smart and joined your study group.
There you go.
Yeah. It was difficult. Like, what does that mean? And what's this mean? And
yeah, you didn't have to hit you with a rock.
Yeah. Yeah, like, just give it to Roger. Let him handle it. He can do it. It's difficult, man. I'll tell you.
Okay. Well, I have a message for Tucker Carlson. If you want me to come and talk about the book, you just give me a call. All right, I'll do
it. Hey, if I can arrange it, would you?
Yes, I would. I would. I will do anything I can to spread the book. You know, we're kind of homebound here because of our situations with the animal habitat and stuff. But if I can get away, I will go. You know, that's why I don't go. I've been asked over and over and over and over again to come to churches and speak and that sort of thing. And I just can't travel out of the country. It's, you know, some of it's because of my health problems, but others is we can't be away from the house more than 24 hours at a time because of the habitat we have here. We take care of a lot of animals, you know, so I can't be gone very long, and my wife can only handle so much. So
so we're
kind of limited, but I will do anything I possibly can to spread the word of this book if it's to show people the information about it. So,
sorry, people, I gotta go.
Okay, everybody.
Bye, Jane.
Bye, Jane.
Bye, Jane.
You don't have to. I gotta go. Thank you.
Bye. Bye.
I've got to go eat before I lose weight.
Thanks, y'all. And we will see you next time.
All right. Love you.
Love you guys.
See y'all.
Love you.
Bye.
We love you very much. Very much.
Stop Facebook. And here, let me stop this one.